In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, please be seated. My only concession is St. Patrick's Day. And is he the Savior? St. Patrick. Are we Irish?
No.
Well, you are. Because he is an Orthodox saint. And we celebrate him because Ireland was Orthodox. At one time, no longer. I didn't wear my green vestments, I wore the yellow, the gold, because today is also a victory of Orthodoxy. And I thought the church would be as full as last week, this week, because we have another victory of Orthodoxy, but I guess I was wishful thinking, because that was the first week of Lent, and here we are the second week. Listen, we got four more weeks to go, so don't get discouraged yet, it's not time. As a matter of fact, the church gives us the cross next week in order to encourage us to remember that we're halfway through and that we're fasting because of the cross of the Lord, because of the Lord's work for us. What is the victory today in Orthodoxy, do you know? Do you know to whom the second Sunday of Lent, of Great Lent, is dedicated since the 16th century? St. Gregory Palamas. Yes, very good. You get an A in class today. Do they do that in Sunday school?
Yes.
Gregory Palamas? Good. Very good. Gregory Palamas was the Archbishop of Salonika, and he was a monastic person. And in the 16th century, the Latin influence had grown in the Eastern world. Thomas Aquinas was probably the most famous theologian of the West in those days and earlier. And the Latinizers were saying that the light that Christ shone with at the Transfiguration, Stibata Lafazza, the Metamorphosis, that light was something created, something very subjective, and temporary, because the West was saying, you cannot really partake of God. You can know about God. You can know God only in his creation and in his existence, but you cannot become a part of him. You can't be a part of God. Now, for us as Orthodox Christians, when we talk about salvation, we talk about theosis, which means divinization, which means that we can become divine. This has been the church's teaching, that our salvation is a means of our growing in divinity with Christ. Through our prayers, through our fasting, through our almsgiving, we grow into that life of Christ so that we become holy. We believe, and Gregory Palamas taught, that light is God's eternal light. God's eternal life, uncreated. It's not a created life, it's him. We say God is love, God is light. In the creed, we say light from light, true God from true God. God is always that light, and Jesus Christ was showing his disciples that he too is God, because he shines with the same light. He wanted to encourage them that when he would be crucified, not to despair because he would rise from the dead, because he's God. And it says in the Troparion that he showed them only as much as they could bear, and they could hardly even look at him because they said it shone, he shone like the sun. It was so brilliant that night, and it wasn't the fullness of his life. So Gregory Palamas emphasized the Orthodox theology that was taught from the beginning, that we can share in that light. We cannot share in God's essence, in his nature. We can't become what God is, but we can share in God, and we can experience God through light, through fragrance, through joy, through peace, through all these gifts of the Holy Spirit that are given to us. It's God's grace. So he made the distinction, which the church held, between God's essence and God's energies. We can never participate in his essence. And I don't want you to think this is getting very theological. it is, but it's very important for our lives. It's the biggest difference between us and the West, that we don't participate in God's essence of what He is, but we participate in His energies of what He throws out at us through the Holy Spirit. We participate in that light. In the 19th century, there was a great Russian saint, Seraphim Sarovsky, Sarov, who had a conversation with a man called Motovilov. And Motovilov said, he wrote, he was a businessman, and he went and had a conversation with this saint. And he wrote a booklet, and he said, the point came where Saint Seraphim shone so much like the sun, I couldn't even look at him. And he said, I can't look at you, Holy Father. And he said, open your eyes, you're shining just as much as I am with this light. That we can experience the light, that we can get the light, that we can become part of God, but not of His nature, only of His energy. And this is a great teaching for us, because it means that, like the church father said, God became a man so that man can become divine. You see the halos that they're shining with? That's the light of Christ in their life. The light that God always had. In the Old Testament, that light is called the Shekinah. It's called the Dosa, the glory of God. God is light. And He has this light. It's nothing that's created. It's something very objective. And it's permanent. It's eternal. It's not temporary. And we become partakers of that divine nature when we partake of the sacrament of His body and blood, when we pray to Him, when we fast, when we ask for His forgiveness and repentance, when we ask for His grace. What is grace? It's His energy. The love that He gives us, the light that He gives us, the joy that He gives us, the peace that He gives us, all these are part of His grace. So it's very important. And today is considered a victory of Orthodoxy. There were three councils that were held. The three together are considered by many of the Orthodox theologians as the ninth ecumenical council. And they vindicated Gregory Palamas' teaching that it was the teaching indeed of the church, and that we did not accept the Western teaching that God cannot be experienced, because God can be experienced. Have you ever experienced God in your life? Well, there'll be times where you will. There'll be times where you will, and it'll be different ways. Through an angel of His, through His grace, through His feeling of being in peace, of being in joy, of suffering, and yet still having faith, you'll experience God's grace. This is His energy, and you can become part of Him. And the gospel today, as well, it relates to this as well. There were four men who brought a paralytic to Christ. And it said they couldn't get near Him, so they had to raise the roof. And they put the pallet down. Now, what is the first thing that Christ said to them? Not, do you want to be healed? He said, your sins are forgiven. You know, when we have the Holy Unction service, and we'll have it on Holy Wednesday, what do we pray for? Healing of soul and body, and forgiveness of sin. Because there is a connection. There is a connection. What that connection is, I can't tell you exactly. I can't say people are sick because they're sinners. No. Sin is in the world. We live in a fallen world. But when we do repent of our sins, when we do forgive, and when we are forgiven by God, we gain a new strength and a new health for our mind, for our souls, and for our bodies. And it brings about a healing, because the church believes in a holistic approach to its salvation. Now, many churches think that the church should be the place where everybody is perfect. How many of you? Or that it's a courtroom, or that it's a legal place where you made this contract with God, I have faith, and you can come to church. You know how the Orthodox looks at the church? As a triage center. That we're all in need of help, and we come here to be healed of our bodies and of our souls. It must be God. To be healed, it's a hospital. It's a hospital. And we're all on the road to recovery until we reach the Lord. Anyway, it said, the Lord said, because of your faith, you will be healed. To whom did he say that? No. To them. It said, he said to them, the four guys who put him down. It doesn't say anything about the faith of the paralytic. I'm assuming he did have faith. But it was the faith of the four guys who put him down. Do you have four guys, four friends, to do that, to raise a roof and put you down? Well, I have George and Mika and Michael. And I'm not talking about that Michael or about that George or about that Mika. I'm talking about that George and that Michael and that Mika. St. Dimitri, St. George, St. Michael, my patrons, and my guardian angel. So don't ever say you're alone. Don't ever say you don't have four friends. Don't ever say that you don't have anybody to raise the roof for you or to help you, because they're all there. And they're standing before Christ's altar, and they're praying for us. And the Lord said, because of their faith, I made you well. Does that make sense? Yeah. Because when we pray to them to intercede with the Lord, this is a proof, kind of a proof text for saints. Why do we need their intercessions? Because they're our patrons, they're our friends, they're our people who stand before the Lord. And why would I not ask them to pray for me if I ask you to pray for me? Where they're right there at the altar, so we ask them to pray for us. And more importantly, during this Lent, are you friend enough to help somebody raise the roof? Would you be willing to do that? To take somebody who's in need and raise the roof for them and bring them to Christ. This is our goal, to be that kind of a friend to those in need, to those who need Christ's forgiveness and Christ's healing. Become a friend to someone. And the symbol is making a phone call and saying, hey, how are you doing? I didn't see you in church today. I know you were there last week, but you weren't there today. Are you okay? And they're going to say, well, 1 week. And you say, well, I missed you. Your place was empty. But all those people that were there last week, follow. Or those who don't come to church and say, hey, you know, we have a place where we meet, where we worship the Lord, where we greet each other, where we're family. Do you have family? Are you all alone? Come be with us. Like the Lord said, like Andrew said to the family, come and see. Come and see. And there are those who come, and they like what they see. Maybe there are those who come and don't like it, and they won't come back. But how will they know unless they come and see? And when you do, when you bring something, you're actually raising the roof for that person and lowering them down to Christ and asking for. Believe that? It's true. It's true. Because we are all, as it said in the prayer today, you are a royal priesthood, a holy nation. He wasn't talking to me. He was talking to all of us. By virtue of your baptism and chrismation, you're all part of the royal priesthood. You're a holy nation, a chosen people. And you have a responsibility to those who believe and yet are not here, and to those who don't believe, to bring them to believe, if possible. And you can do that through your prayers, through your love, through your kindness, and through your friendship. So, besides just fasting, do these things. And it's even more important.